student in Paris. So I'm French, and I'm sorry for my accent. I'm working for the Centre de Recherche et de Restauration des Musées de France Laboratory, which is under the Louvre Museum, and also for OCE, which is a company that develops printing systems. And together, OCE and the Louvre, we wanted to see how far printing, in our case 3D printing, could help the conservator in his work, and in particular in the case of fragmentary and incomplete artifacts such as some archaeological objects. So I should have added in the title as a microscale brief, because this is a major difference with what has been seen here yesterday and today. I am working at the surface scale of object as a microscale. So the artifact on which we worked is part of a rim made of 8 broken pieces, as you can see here. Piece number 4 is the largest one, it's curved, so the rim circles the wheel. Pieces 1 and 3, as pieces 4 and 5, are separated. The surface is covered by sediments, quite damaged, at different colors like blue, green, beige, and some parts are missing. The object is dated from the 20th century BC and comes from Susa in the current Iran. Susa was one of the capital cities of the Elam Kingdom, and French archaeologists were present in the area during around a century thanks to a French-Iranian agreement and a very great name of French archaeologists search there, such as Jacques de Morgan or Roland Mekonnen. From those excavation campaigns came a very famous pieces of the period, such as the massive bronze statue of the Queen Napiresou, or thousands of seals revealing information on kings, administration, people, and life. Our rim element is made of bronze, and was part of a full rim similar to this one, which is exhibited in the Louvre. It's made of 6 curved elements joined together with rivets, probably circling a solid wooden wheel, as the spoked wheel was invented later. In any case, our rim element is incomplete, fragmentary, and part of a group to be restored. The goal of the restoration is to remove a little bit of sedimentation to recover the bronze aspect, but mainly is to stick all the fragments back together as roof plans, maybe to show it inside the museum. And the main problem about the reassembly concerns fragments 4, 5, 6, and 4, 7, 8. So I don't know if it's really clear on the picture here, but fragment 4 is curved and quite long, and fragment 5 is separated. It's here, and very fragile with a rivet and a superior part. And fragment 6 comes above in the right orientation. So if we consider it from top view, we have the curved part 4, joined to 6 and 5, and a missing part. Which is hatched here, and that's the same on the other side, part 4, a missing hatched part, fragment 8 joined to 7. From side view, you see here also the missing parts. So to stick the fragments all together, the restorer has to create a filling for stability reasons. Part 4, 5, 6 and 4, 7, 8 can't be put together without a filling, and instead of using a traditional restoration process, such as resina, we use this application to try 3D printing inside the restoration process. And the 3D printing process on which we are working is an additive method where layers of colored inks are superimposed in order to create a leaf. It differs from regular 3D printing systems as it allows color creation. And also very fine modulation of the surface. But it can only create a low relief object. This is surface 3D printing. We thought that this technique was adapted to raw object because it makes gloss control and color control possible. To print the missing part, we do have to record the appearance of the whole object. The first point is the relief. We perform a 3D scan of pieces with an ICON smart scan, which is a structured light scanner. And deformations of the fringe allows reconstruction of the object geometries. The resolution of the scanner is 20 micrometers in the lateral directions and 1 micrometer in the vertical dimension. So this is fully sufficient to get a precise representation of the surface. Here you have fragment 5, where surface texture is nicely visible without the eye being disturbed by color. And here you have fragment 6. And with simple software such as MeshLab, you can put together both fragments. And you can create the filling with another software. So this is here. The filling is created by just copying and inversing the geometry of fragment 5 on the new part. And here you have 4, 5, and 6 together. So then you can extract the filling, add that chosen geometry and texture, and it gives you a height map, which is the information you will send to the printer. So this is here on the right. And let's note that the major issue here is the computation time, which is quite long. After the texture, the second information you need is gloss. So gloss is the ability of a surface to reflect the image of a source. It is measured with a gloss meter on a scale going from 0 to 100, and 100 is a very glossy surface when 0 is a matte one. So obviously the bronze is very matte, but it's not the case of the inks we are working with in the printing system. So how do we do to print such a matte surface? We use the additive printing process to add roughness on top of the relief layer, inside the white layer. So when adding roughness, we will decrease the gloss. And we know that the roughness we add can't be random, nor the real roughness of the object, because of the resolution of the printer. So we found that a specific pattern made of micro pillars, here one scale is about 100 micrometers wide, allows the gloss control by simply changing its height. So if we print a surface with micro pillars at 10 micrometers height, the gloss will be around 6, and at 100 micrometers height, it will be around 1. So it seems not a big difference, but for the eye, it's quite important, because human eye is very sensitive in the matte range. So we covered the filling with micro pillars at 100 micrometers height, and we sent it to the printer. In fact, we know that it's not enough, because if we build a space where all glossy and matte aspects can be printed with a system as the blue point, and some real matte objects as the squares, we see that the bronze is quite far from our printing abilities. That's a limitation due to the resolution of the printing system. The printer can't produce a visual sensation as matte as bronze. But it's not fully a problem because of two things. First, a large observation distance modifies the perception we have of the surface and will increase the matte sensation. And second, in France, the restorer's cut of FX implies that the modification we make has to be visible by anybody. So by producing a satiny, glossy effect at short distance, the print will satisfy this one. And finally, we made the color acquisition by taking calibrated pictures with a color trigger that give us high resolution pictures on which we cut out the shape of the filling. Like this. And we send this information to the printer. Of course, when adding a colored layer on top of a matte layer, we change again the visual sensation. So we proceed to specific calibration of the printer in the matte range, depending on ink ratio to solve this problem. So we have relief, gloss, and color information, and we just have to put them together to print something. When only printing relief, we get a monochromatic glossy filling, which has the advantage of presenting a textured surface that can be modified by the restorer, and the restorer always wants to modify something. By printing relief and color, we get a glossy surface, and by printing relief, color, and gloss, we get fillings that produce a better visual sensation. So when texturing the white on the layer, we change the visual sensation and make the print looking more like a natural object, even if it keeps a satiny aspect at close distance. To finish the restoration process, we need to answer three more questions. What is the ink composition? How does it react with the glue? And how does it react under light? And we will compare it with other restoration techniques. And you can see here on the picture the filling added to the object. Here color has to be improved a bit, but you can see the texture quite well. So to conclude, let's say that the 3D printing technique we work with is different from other processes on the market, as it allows texture, color, and gloss management in one print. And once all appearance parameters have been recorded, the filling can be printed several times, which is also an advantage for further restoration campaigns. The readability criteria is resolved. The change of the lightning or turning around the object is enough to see the filling. And the restorer doesn't have to paint the print or retouching the surface as they usually do on regular food. At the technical level, color management has to be improved a little bit. And let's say that the resolution of the printer, which is today around 50 micrometers, is the main limitation to get some matte aspect. Thank you.